This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
You know, I hesitate to use the word legend because I think it is sometimes overused, but today I'm going to use it. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. Sheila Varian, who passed away on March 6th of 2016, was truly a legendary horsewoman. Certainly anybody who's been involved with Arabian horses, English or Western, especially in the show world, probably is very aware of the breeding program that Varian Arabians had. And I think something like 10 generations now of award-winning, show-winning performance horses that came out of that program. Sheila Varian was the one who started it, and as I said, she passed away on March 6th at the age of 78. I don't think of her as an old person at all. In fact, if you saw her, that would be probably one of the last things you thought about. She was tall and slender and very graceful, always had a smile on her face, and you felt like you knew her the first time you met her. She was just one of those kind of good-hearted people, and I think horses sense that about her as well, which was one reason she was so successful, both in the show ring and as a breeder. I had the chance to get to know her a little bit through the Light Hands Horsemanship Clinics that took place in Santa Ynez, California, not too far from where she lived in Arroyo Grande. And I had this one opportunity to do an interview with her, and you're going to hear that today, my talk with Sheila Varian. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back.
French Broad Dude Ranch in eastern Tennessee could be America's best vacation ranch. There's fishing, rafting, square dancing, crafts, team penning, a cattle drive, and great food. Most important, you'll learn how to ride a horse in balance on your very first lesson.
The very second you get in that right position, it will work for your benefit, and you'll look like you've been riding your whole life.
Save big right now on your family's dream vacation. Call 800-995-7678 or visit FrenchBroadDudeRanch.com.
If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never, ever offends. Every week, you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world, like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Animal Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit TrueValue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM Premium Horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Animal Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Land.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. So glad you could join us today on the Horse Show. I have on the line with me a new friend. I've known of her for a long time, but I've only known her for the past couple years, Miss Sheila Varian. Sheila, welcome to the Horse Show.
Thank you.
Like I said, I've known about you for such a long time. I mean, anybody that's has anything to do with the Arabian industry has heard the name of Varian Arabians. But I was so pleased when I met you that you are so easygoing, almost happy-go-lucky. You make people happy, I think, when you're around them. You have a great smile. There's that laugh. You have that great smile, that great laugh, and you use them a lot. How come you're such a positive person?
Oh, gosh, I don't know.
You probably weren't expecting that question.
No, that's a good question. I kind of hate feeling bad, and so my choice is feel bad or feel good, and if I can, I'm going to feel good. Now, just like everybody, I sure had tough times, and I know what they are, and I think it's the old put one foot in front of the other and just keep marching. I subscribe to that.
I had the feeling that you're that kind of a person, kind of a glass half full sort of a person.
Well, I think you are too, and so probably that's why we've enjoyed each other's company so much. A couple of times now that we've gotten to talk, not very long. We really haven't had any deep conversations, but I'm looking forward to it.
Well, me too, and we're just going to share that with everybody out there listening today. I want to go back. I kind of have the broad brush picture of your life. I'd like to kind of go back and just hear how you got started doing what you do today. So take me back to the beginning, young Sheila, first horse, that kind of a thing.
8 years old, had been crawling around on my hands and knees since I was born, and my folks thought, I guess, that I would never stand up, and I didn't seem to stop whinnying. And my sister was 8 years older than I, and so she convinced my father that we should get a horse. And my dad got talked into it because he liked to hunt deer. And so he went up to the neighbor ranchers, and they had a 4-year-old Percheron Morgan mare that they had been hunting off of, and they thought that that would work for my dad, and I could have a horse. And, of course, as all little kids do, I grabbed hold of that horse and quickly eliminated all of her remembering to stay ground tied and not shy and all the rest. And I rode bareback. I fell off regularly. And somebody had told me that to be a cowgirl, I had to fall off 3 times. And I took it to mean 3 times a day. So I would fling myself off, Judy, 3 times a day, bouncing along on the gravel road quite happily. And Judy would quite often run home, and I would just trot along behind her. And you could run along behind Judy, and she would watch you, and when you stopped, she would graze, and when you walked, she walked, and, you know, that's the way you went home.
Mm-hmm. That sounds so much like my cousin's Shetland pony that was the first equine that I had much to do with, and he had a way of getting rubbing me off or knocking me off or something, and then he would graze until I could come up behind him. And then he would either trot off, or when I got within kicking range, he'd kick me. So he had a pretty good sense of where I was at all times. So that was your first horse, Judy.
Yeah, I rode her many, many, many miles. By the time I was 12, and my sister, see, then finally got a horse. And so my sister had friends with 4 boys that were my sister's age. So they were older than I, but they were great guys. And so I got to go along when they rode. And so we would ride 20 miles, 30 miles everywhere. Wow. And because my sister was going, I got to go. And those boys were so, so great and so kind. And we raced horses on the beach. We played because I could ride to the beach. And we had 30 miles of beach. And we raced. We played King of the Mountain. I mean, we really rode pretty darn hard, and so I got out and about as a little kid. I was everywhere.
Now, was this in California?
Uh-huh. 3 miles from where I live now.
Really? Have you lived your whole life there in that in the Santa Ynez area?
I moved once. I put everything in a paper bag and moved out here. And that was my big move of life.
Where were you living before that?
In a little town called Halcyon, 3 blocks by 3 blocks, and it's still just the same. And now I live outside of Arroyo Grande, which was just close to Halcyon.
Mm-hmm. What is it about the California mystique that you enjoy so much? I know that you celebrate it in what you do and in your look and some of the tack you use and so forth.
You know, I don't know why I got so touched with the California, other than probably when I was about 12 or 13, I had the amazing good fortune to meet a woman named Sid Mary Spencer. She went by Sid. And she worked her family's ranch, which was about 4 miles from us, 5 miles from us. And my dad had gone out to do electrical work for her, and she had Morgan horses, and I looked into being able to ride with her. And she wasn't a teacher, but she definitely was a mentor.
Mm-hmm.
And I think probably that's where I really got hooked into, because she trained a horse in a hackamore and a two-rein and then finished it in a spade bit, and she did all of her own ranch work. And my family, we lived on an acre, so I didn't have anything of that sort growing up. And I really loved that. And so that's where I got started with all that.
Do you still think of her often in what you do today?
Oh, sure, because I'm always doing things that Sid did. I mean, you know, you learn your things from people that you loved and admired, and then, of course, forever after, they're right.
Mm-hmm.
And I always have fun telling everybody that, but that's the way I learned, so that's right.
Now, do you have young people that you mentor in the way that Sid mentored you?
I used to, because I had an apprenticeship program, mainly because we couldn't afford to hire help. So,
good idea.
Yeah. Well, California then. Now they make you pay them. But then we didn't pay anybody, and they stayed forever, it seemed like. And so some of the dearest people came and stayed years. And so I guess you could say that was mentoring. Certainly they were apprenticing, and I felt very responsible to be there. And as a matter of fact, I always was there, because that's all we did was work horses 7 days a week, and pretty much 24 hours a day. Now I'm in my office, and I have other people helping me, but I'm still out there in the middle of it all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you are one of the ridingest people that I know. I mean, every time I talk to you, you just come back from a gather, or you're heading to one, or you've been working. Is that typical, or is it just the time of year I usually catch up with you is kind of high season for that?
Well, this time of year is my very favorite time of year, because that's when everybody is gathering the ranches, and they're all shipping. So from the middle of May to the end of June, you just ride as hard as you can ride. And I really love that.
Boy, doesn't that sound like fun. My guest is the great Sheila Varian. When we come back, she's going to tell us the story of her first horse and when she first met Tom Dorrance. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com.
Hi, this is Michael Martin Murphy, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Thank you, Mr. Murphy. I had to use that particular liner to get us back into the show today because I know how much Michael Martin Murphy loves real cowboys and real cowgirls like my guest, Sheila Varian. Sheila, how did you get started with Arabian horses?
Well, it must be that I was reading the Walter Farley Black Stallion books when I was a kid. That's one thing. And Marguerite Henry's King of the Wind. And they were, you know, I don't know. Did you read those?
Sure, you bet.
I mean, every kid ought to read the Black Stallion Walter Farley books. And I met Walter Farley, and he was such wonderful man. And, you know, Imagination, Island Stallion, A Dreaming of All That. And then I saw a filly at a horse show that I was at, named Farlotta, a yearling, and she wasn't very pretty. I guess I thought she was beautiful, but I guess she wasn't so very pretty. She was sort of a muddy gray, and her little face wasn't the prettiest face. Anyway, I came home and I told my folks about this wonderful filly I had seen, this wonderful Arabian filly, and never thought any more about it. And a year later, when she was two, she'd been purchased by a girl in Santa Barbara, and she was way too much horse for her. And so my folks got a call from some friends that said that this mare Farlotta was for sale because she was totally out of control and the girl couldn't handle her, and, you know, on with that story. And so my folks had never seen her. And my uncle came down, and he gave my folks $500 in a paper bag. They had not seen this mare, and so they told me that I was going to get Farlotta, and I thought I was going to die. And we drove to Santa Barbara, and to my parents' horror, here was this very thin, very scrawny mare standing in a pipe corral by herself, mane rubbed out where she'd been trying to put her head through the grass to eat the grass. And when you walked up to the corral, she ran at you with her ears back. And my folks must have looked in horror, and I looked at her and said, "Isn't she beautiful?" And they were stuck. I mean, what were they going to do? They couldn't do anything. So we had our trailer at that time was wooden. Trailers were sort of wooden. Mm-hmm. And took a long time to get Farlotta in the trailer with everybody's help. But when she got in the trailer and they got the back up, she started just kicking the whole back out of the trailer. So there were splinters and pieces of wood flying in every direction. And I jumped into her manger, and we had a 2-hour drive home. And when we got home, Farlotta and I were bonded at the hip. She was forever mine.
Wow.
And she just became a wonderful, wonderful horse. And that was my first horse that I took all the way through the hackamore to the 2-rein to the spade bit.
Now, how old were you when this happened?
I guess I was probably 14. 13.
So did you had you already been around Sid at that time?
Or yes.
Okay, so you were starting to get some sense about how to handle horses and what they needed
from us. I mean, I'd watched her, sure.
Yeah. Now, were there any other mentors in your life that really influenced you in some
way? Well, then Tom Dorrance, probably 10 or 15 years later, came to the ranch. And when Tom Dorrance came, I was already doing very well, but nobody had any idea of this natural horsemanship that Tom came with. And he just drove up the hill and in his little tiny truck. I didn't know who he was, and he wasn't somebody special then. And got out of his truck, and in his typical Tom Dorrance, very, very kind way, said he'd like to see my horses. So he must have seen me sometime, and by that time I was showing Rontessa. So he had to have seen me show her somewhere to have some idea to come and find me.
Mm-hmm.
I was teaching school by that time. I had gone through college with my horse, and I was teaching school back in the school that I went to, my Royal Grande High School, and then I went back and taught there. Maybe 1960, something like that. So up he drove, and he said he would just so like to look at my horses. Well, heck, nobody came to see my horses, so I was thrilled. Nothing better than being able to show somebody my horses. So I had a little six-stall barn, and I lived out on this little. My father had been able to acquire a little 21-acre piece of land. I went out with Tom, and he started showing me all these very interesting things I'd never even thought of, this suppling and softening and leading with the foot and an ear and being able to take hold of a horse's nose and have them just relax their nose in your hand and move to your hands. And so I was just enthralled, and he stayed an hour, and then he drove away. And it took me a year, and then he came back the next year. And, of course, they never called or said they were coming, or they just drive up. That's the way all of them were.
Sure.
Tom and Chief Rojas and all those wonderful old people I really got an opportunity to know. And so up he drives, and I had been fascinated with it, and so I was working hard on all that for a year, because it took me a year to get it to where I really got comfortable and understood, because nobody else was doing this, so you weren't seeing it anywhere. And then he came and stayed 3 days, and we rode horses, with just an Indian rope tied around their jaw. And he didn't have the flag at that time. He had a little poker, which they didn't like, and that's why he went to a flag eventually. And then he would go on, and he had kind of made himself a circle. And he was going over to the 25 Ranch in Nevada and working all of their horses and seeing how quickly he could get them under saddle for the cowboys and with his methods. And so he said that he was taking 5 years to learn about horses. He'd stopped doing what he was doing, and he was simply learning about horses. And that was Tom.
Still to come, Sheila remembers Arnold Chief Rojas, one of the genuine authorities on the California vaquero. My guest again is the great Sheila Varian. This is The Horse Show. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. We'll be back. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter in, corrals.com. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Animal Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM Premium Horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Animal Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi, everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD-TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never, ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD-TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD-TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lamemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Thank you, Woodman. We are back, everybody. My guest is Sheila Varian, and we were just talking about those early days, Sheila, when you met Tom Dorrance before he was famous. Were you surprised that what he was showing you back then caught on with the general public and became what is today known as natural horsemanship?
Well, I wouldn't say I was surprised because it has taken a long, long time. I knew Ray Hunt really well, and Ray was the one that was willing to go out and carry on with Tom's work a lot. I suppose I wasn't surprised because I was just too busy doing it myself.
Mm-hmm.
You see, I never ran in a group. I didn't live near anybody. Now, I've kind of gotten to where I've known everybody, but I've never traveled with them. I know Monty Roberts really well, of course, Tom and Ray Hunt and Ernie Morris and Chief Rojas, who's fascinating. They lived different places, and you didn't necessarily go there. I was home. I was working. I was teaching or keeping my ranch going. So I really didn't get out and about very much. Is that making any sense?
It does make sense. I wanted to ask you about Chief Rojas. Arnold Rojas wrote a marvelous book, and a number of them, and I think the one that I'm thinking of was called These Were the Vaqueros. Is that the correct title? What was he like? Was he a vaquero himself? I mean, was he writing about the life he lived?
How many generations he was from the Tejon Ranch, what, four or five, and went to school through the third grade and ended up writing those books. But he also traveled around like Tom did. And they just had these places they would go. And they always arrived unannounced. And the chief, he would drive in the yard. And at that time, I didn't have a gate. I didn't have any trees. I didn't have anything. I just had dirt. And the chief would roar in, and I had two girls that apprenticed for me that I've stayed very close to all these years. They were the very first apprentices, and they were happy girls. So the chief, he loved all us three girls. He just loved these three girls that were happy girls and laughing and riding and carrying on all day, and he would drive in, and he, being raised, I guess, out, he was really loud. and he had a big booming voice. And so as soon as he would drive in the yard, we would be laughing because you could hear him across the canyon. And he would just drive around the back of the barn, and his windows would be open, and he would be talking, and he would stop. And, of course, he had one of these tiny little trucks, too, although he finally did get sort of a little camper, and jump out, and then he would trade. He traded bits, and he did teeth. And he could walk into any stallion's stall and never put a halter on it and just take off with him yelling loudly, as he always did, not at the horse, but just talking loud. And he made all of his own tools, and he would stuff them in these horses' mouths, and they would all just stand there with their eyes as soft as could be. And he'd be shoving this tool back and forth, and he'd be talking loud, and stuff would be going on, and the horse would just stand there. He was really quite something.
He was floating their teeth? Was that what he was doing? Wow.
He could float anything's teeth.
Huh.
And he always wanted to do it alone, and he never put a halter on one.
Yeah. Well, in your experience, Sheila, because you grew up in this area, we're talking about Chief Rojas, one of the foremost chroniclers, if you will, of the vaquero life. When you think of the vaquero, what is the good that comes to mind? And the flip side of that is what is the not so good that comes to mind?
Well, the good is the history, the beauty, the style, the pride, real pride in their equipment, pride in how their horse looked, pride in what they did. The not so good was it was a very harsh time. Certainly Tom's gentle methods were not anything that a vaquero ever thought of. I mean, that was a hard life, and they really probably enjoyed the hard life. It was much more of a submission thing than it became, of course, when Tom got involved, then it became a partnership with the horse.
Right.
So it was a very tough time. So what I take from it is the beauty and the style and the look that a horse has, and yet I know that the bad stuff, the rough stuff, and some of it I've tried a little bit, and it just, I couldn't do it. It, first of all, it doesn't work for me, and secondly, that's too tough for me. Too tough.
It's interesting because, and we talked about this a bit at Light Hands this year when we were kind of exploring the vaquero thing. You know, I think of Tom Dorrance as really being a master in the use of the snaffle bit and using that a lot in starting young horses and so forth. But of course, the snaffle didn't exist in the true vaquero system. So it's almost like he brought in a different tool and a different mindset that was kind of an alternative approach.
Well, I think I know that's true. And I can remember sitting and arguing with Ray Hunt about the fact, because he was using a snaffle and I was totally into a hackamore because that's what I knew how to use. And I was very adamant, always being very self-assured that I was right. And of course, I wasn't. But anyway, why a hackamore was good and a snaffle wasn't any good. And the truth was, I just simply didn't know how to use a snaffle. And when I finally learned how to use one, then I start my colts in a snaffle and then can use a hackamore too. But I don't start in a hackamore.
Mm-hmm.
See, because what they did, the vaqueros, is they made a horse really hurt in a hackamore, so he was afraid of it.
Oh.
And so, you know, if he ran off, which they didn't much mind if he did, then they could bang him around on the side of a neck or double him. Well, they just doubled him right to the ground. I mean, they'd take him down a fence and dump him. And so they made him so sore that the horses were afraid. Well, I mean, I could never make a horse. I made him sore, and all I did was make him mad. Mm-hmm. Because I couldn't make him sore enough. And then our horses, too, have become, you know, they started them at 5, and we're now starting them at, well, God forbid that the quarter horses get started before they're 2, but
right.
I start mine pretty much as they're turning 3. Well, they didn't start them that early.
Mm-hmm.
So they were tougher.
Right.
We got a different kind of horse today. Yeah. And I mean, we all need to thank God Tom Dorrance came along, because if he had not, there would be a lot less quality horsemen than there are out there. I mean, I looked at those John Ensign and Lester Buckley, and those are horsemen.
Mm-hmm.
But I never saw Tom on a finished horse.
I kind of got the impression that he particularly enjoyed the young ones.
Yeah, he really enjoyed the young horses, and he really knew. He never said it out loud, but I'm sure Tom knew that he really had a very important thing to do.
Interesting thing, though, he at least in his later years, it seems, that he really kind of shied away from the fame that it was starting to bring him. Like, he really didn't want to be the centerpiece of a revolution, or the godfather of horsemanship, or any of that. And at one point, I think I talked to Margaret one time when I was researching revolution in horsemanship, and or maybe it was Brian Newbert that told me this, but one of them said they thought about even disconnecting their phone, because he was just starting to get too many calls from people, you know, that had heard about him. And it wasn't necessarily people wanting his wisdom, but they were just kind of interested in him because he was a famous person. Like,
yeah, and he really resented that. And there was a period of time, if there was to be something written, he did not want anybody using his name. And he was always gracious to me. I would send him what I was going to write, and he was always said yes. In fact, he wrote for me for the Cowgirl Hall of Fame.
And as I mentioned earlier, Sheila Varian was inducted into the Cowgirl Hall of Fame. When we return, some of Sheila's thoughts on why Tom Dorrance didn't like to see the commercialization of horsemanship. You've got to hear this.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. The Hoof Cinch treats founder from a whole new angle.
It just forces that new growth along the bone, and it actually reattaches.
Unlike conventional founder treatments, the Hoof Cinch is applied to the outer hoof wall. It stabilizes the capsule and reduces pain immediately. In 12 to 16 weeks, horses can return to whatever they did before. Get the full story and watch a short video at hoofcinch.com. Don't give up on your foundered horse. Take the first step and learn about the Hoof Cinch at hoofcinch.com.
Colts for Cancer with Sean Patrick. Join us April 1st from Friday at 6 p.m. until Sunday at 4 p.m. for a weekend of colt starting and training demonstrations. The cost is $20 per day, and all proceeds go to the Childhood Cancer Foundation. We'll start four colts under saddle for the first time. The Childhood Cancer Foundation was a tremendous help to my family during the past year, and I promise you a great weekend. Colts for Cancer in New Smyrna Beach. Go to SeanPatrickTraining.com for details.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on four standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
We do appreciate your help, folks. My guest is Sheila Varian of Varian Arabians, foremost breeder of Arabian horses in the country. And we've been talking about her early time with Tom Dorrance, the father of natural horsemanship, long before he really became famous for this. And as his methods caught on and it started kind of being commercialized, he actually kind of pulled back a little bit from that, didn't he?
I think he felt that this was a gift that should be given and money shouldn't be made over it. Mm-hmm. And there was a period of time when I think he and Ray were not very close because of that.
Well, it's interesting that those two, we always think of them as mentor and kind of protege. And in some respects, from this distance in time, what they said and what they did and the methods and so forth kind of all blur together to where, you know, it's most likely that a lot of it started with Tom, but we don't know what part Ray really added into it at this point in time. But as people... And I never met Tom Dorrance. I only met Ray Hunt once, and he was very cordial to me. But the stories, you always hear how gentle and sweet and wonderful Tom was. By the same token, there are lots of stories out there about just how kind of tough and mean-spirited sometimes
yeah,
that Ray could be. And
yep.
Of course,
yeah,
it's I don't want to say that without saying he had his reasons, and the context certainly makes a difference. And I think in some cases, those stories, he was trying to shake people up a little bit and wake them up that they needed to do something or they were going to get hurt. But you couldn't have two more different personalities, at least the way they've kind of come to be known from this distance.
But I think this was the connection. The connection was that Ray recognized what Tom had to offer of all of the people that saw Tom. So he was the one that glued on to Tom to learn it.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't have the same personality that Tom did at all, but he was the one that saw what Tom was doing and that it was of value. And he was traveling and going, and then Tom got upset because he was making money on it, and that didn't feel good to Tom, but it was necessary because how could you do it without it?
Right.
This is what I think. I think anybody that will go out there day after day and say the same thing over to people that don't get it and keep going deserve every penny they can earn.
Yeah, yeah. It's not an easy thing to do, for sure.
I just wouldn't do it. You know, I think it's fun to go do a seminar or two, and I have people come here for my spring fling, and I like telling them how we start colts and what to do and stopping in the middle of whatever we're doing and explaining what that is. I like that twice a year. I don't want to go do it all the time.
Right, right.
I want to go get on my horse and go gather the cows.
I know what you mean. Let me go back to Arabians for just a moment. You have a fairly big operation now. You're known throughout the industry. You have really quite a commitment. Your name is almost synonymous with Arabians. What is it about the Arabian horse that speaks to you?
Oh, well. Well, first of all, they're a horse of many talents. You know, I happen to like to ride all sorts of different disciplines. I don't now so much, but I did. I rode English horses. I rode Western horses. I rode stock horses. If I could catch it, I was going to ride it. And in our shows, at the Arab shows, the divisions, I mean, these horses can do more different things than any other breed by far. People don't know that because they don't go to the show to see, but an English horse in our breed, I mean, they trot big, and the reining mm-hmm. horses are stopping hard, and the hunters are trotting strong. You know, they have so much capability to do so many different things. And then they're beautiful, and I happen to like things that are pretty, and they like me. And so when you walk out to an Arab, he leaves his food to come over and say hello to you, and most other breeds just keep eating.
What do you think is the biggest misconception that people have about Arabian horses?
That they're very nervous and very fragile. And unfortunately, our breed, everything had to be imported from other parts of the world because they all had to be purebred.
Mm-hmm.
So you couldn't make up a breed. And therefore, the very best of the horses, Arabian horses, are often not seen outside of the Arabian world. So, you know, where I'm riding out and taking my horses and doing other things with my so-called ranch horses, you know, there's not a lot of people that have the opportunity to go out on ranches like I do. So they don't necessarily learn how to do that. Or they don't, English classes, they have in Arab shows. So there's, if you would go to an Arab show like Scottsdale, where mm-hmm. there's 2,500 Arabians, then people are just stunned that they can do so many other things so well, so differently. And, you know, children can ride Arabian stallions in our breed because they're not a tough horse. Now, as a ranch horse, probably a half Arab would be great. A purebred, on the whole, you know, I think Tom Dorrance hasn't quite made inroads into all of the ranch worlds that he would like, because there's still a lot of rougher stuff that goes on. And an Arab just doesn't need it. You know, an mm-hmm. Arab, and you shake your finger at him, and he says, okay, I get it, I'm with you. Where some other of the horses, they get tough on them, and sometimes overly tough, but some of those horses can take it, too.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think an Arab, you know, he doesn't want to get hurt. He's a pretty sensitive kind of guy, and that I like it. I always say I don't want to sweat.
In most breeds, there's kind of the modern incarnation of the breed, which often becomes a bit typey and kind of exaggerated, almost a caricature even. This has happened in many different breeds. And then you have kind of the old style or the foundation type horse. Where is your preference in with the Arabians?
I'm right down the middle of the road.
Mm-hmm.
I want one that I think is pretty and attractive to ride. I do not want to ride a common-looking horse.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want one so extreme that his face looks like you couldn't put a bridle or a hackamore on it, or mm-hmm. that he can't breathe.
Right.
You know, the Arabian is supposed to have a neck that isn't so fine that he still has good wind intake. His eyes should be large. I mean, I wouldn't say it's the old type Arabian, because I think mine have more bone,
mm-hmm.
because I do ride in a different manner. So even my English horses, and I ride, see, we school all across the board here, English horses, Western horses. When the mine are born, my deal is that they can pick what they want to do as long as they do whatever they're going to do really well.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been my breeding premise, is that as long as they can do something really well, they have a place in my program. If they don't have the personality, or if they aren't strong enough, or if they can't stay sound enough, then they have to move along. That I got through about 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So now I just don't have horses that don't fit. They always can do something. So I just don't have what they call as culls anymore.
Well, you're a fascinating lady, truly one of the most interesting people I've run into in a long time. And I'm so happy.
Well, you know what, Mr. Lamb, I can tell you the same about you, and you are the best lecturer out there keeping me, whose mind can wander in those kind of situations, interested of anybody I've known. So,
well, thank you so much. That is so sweet of you to say that.
Well, it's just the facts.
Well, let's tell people where they can learn more about Sheila Varian and Varian Arabians, and maybe they'll want to come and see some of your horses.
Well, we're going to have a summer jubilee this year. We have it every year, and then we have a spring fling in April. I can brag a little, but I think we have the very best event of this kind, certainly in our breed, and I bet in most breeds. It's extremely pretty. It's very educational. We offer horses for sale, but I do not auction because I want to look at the people that are going to buy them and make sure that they're buying the right horse. We're very particular about how the horses have been raised so that if a person buys one of my horses and they don't quite know what they're doing, the horse is going to be able to handle the situation and try and figure out what that person is talking about, because the horses leave here with a naive and open mind. They don't leave here thinking that things are going to be bad. Mm. And they've been really educated on good manners and how to be a good citizen. So people love these horses. Yeah. And we've bred them very carefully through the years. So if they want to contact us, they can go to our website at VarianArabians.com, www.VarianArabians.com. And if they want to contact me, they can just pick up the telephone, because the telephone number's on it, and call me.
Yeah.
And someone will address what they want, and we do a very good job. We're just a really good farm.
Yeah.
I've got 3 employees for 25 years.
Oh, my gosh.
And a numbers of them for 20, for 18, for 15. You know, it's a good place to live and work.
All right, dear. Well, I appreciate so much the time that you've spent with me on the phone today. I wish it could have been in person, because then I could see your pretty smile and just kind of enjoy the way you fill up a room. My guest has been the great Sheila Varian, VarianArabians.com, V-A-R-I-A-N, Arabians.com. Sheila, thank you so much, and I will see you soon, I hope.
Come to our summer jubilee.
I will try. Thank you
okay.
so much. You know, I have a special memory of Sheila. It was the last time I saw her. It was at Light Hands Horsemanship, and I was walking towards my trailer. She was in her truck, and we just kind of stopped and chatted for a bit, and she said some really nice things about what I do in the horse industry through radio and television, and that meant so much to me, coming from such a marvelous horsewoman as Sheila Varian. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.